There's a lot of overlaps in those areas because the poor and the illiterate, as a result of not being equipped to be able to fill paperwork out and go to the doctors and ask the right questions, they are vulnerable. They're in a vulnerable situation. So I'm going to talk specifically related to education, which the experience I have from in the last few months. We started an NGO in Janakyapuri, right in Rajamar, which does an after-school program for about 40 children, eighth graders like you. So the government school is, down the street, and immediately after their school ends, they come to us after school, where we spend about an hour and a half with them and sort of help them with their schoolwork. And so as a result, what we have learned is that, what you guys have in order to be successful learners at school, it's quite difficult when you have, I would say the majority of the children in our program have parents who are not able to read and write. So they're not able to get any assistance at home in terms of their schoolwork. I mean, sometimes we have parents who need to take their child to the bank because they can't fill out the basic paperwork. So you can imagine the challenges, the kind of support and encouragement your parents have been able to give to you at home. Oftentimes these kids are not able to get that. And in spite of that, they're able to come to school and, make an attempt to get themselves an education. There are things that are working in the Indian education system. So before we go into the things that are not working, it would be great to hear from you guys. But what are the things that are working in the Indian education system for the poor? Any thoughts? What about that it's free? So schooling is free in India. You only have to pay for your uniform. So that's a big plus. And also that it's accessible. That at least in the urban communities, there are schools that are available and accessible for children to walk to. They're usually within a 20 to 30 minute walking distance. What else? Anything else that you guys can think of? Yeah.
Sometimes there's food. Often that kind of allows these families to let their children come to school.
Exactly. There's a hot meal that's provided at school that's also included. So kids get a hot meal at school. And then finally, this is one thing that, you could say is a negative point, but some people think it's a positive. It's much debated. So one thing that is in the Indian system, in 2010, there was a law that was passed where children are not allowed to be detained. So you're not allowed to fail. So even if all you do is in your final exam, you just write your name down and you don't make any attempts and you have no knowledge to answer the question, the children are not allowed to fail. They're supposed to be promoted to the next year. This happens until eighth grade. So what started out as a way to try and reduce the stress and the anxiety on the children's lives has actually had a very negative impact on the learning, because teachers and schools are not necessarily held accountable for the learning that the kids are doing. And then parents have no way of knowing that their children are not learning because their child is passing. So it actually is one of the reasons why NGOs like us have to help step in, because there's a big gap in between what the kids are supposed to be learning and where they are. I mean, we have children in our program who in eighth grade are still struggling with basic addition because the help that they needed in the early years they didn't get because they got a free pass into the next grade. So there's never, their issues weren't highlighted. And so as a result, that's one of the challenges that the schools face here. Do you want to move on to your...
Yeah, we can do some help work. My name's Pratiksha Samaya. I'm a GP or an internist by training, and I'm a parent here. I have a daughter in sixth grade. And along now, Rupi and I do this enrichment program, but I used to run the clinic for street children with the Salam Balak Trust at New Delhi Railway Station for many years. So what I want to do, first of all, I think the one way for you to understand a little bit of where these children come from is start thinking about how you've managed in families and as people when you've been ill. So we're just going to count you out into two groups. So if you can start 1, 2.
1, 2, 3.
1.
Oh, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, Two.
Two.
One.
Two.
One.
Great. We can have the ones on this side of the room and the twos on this side of the room. Sorry to separate you from your friends. So what we can do, if we can just all go together in your groups, I want you to just take a couple of minutes to, between your groups, find a story. So one person's going to tell a story about how maybe when you were unwell, what happened, where you were, who took you to the hospital, what your treatment was, and where it resolved, okay? So if you can, you might need to huddle together a bit. You can have to find one story. And then one story And then what I want you to do is to pick one spokesperson who will tell the rest of the group the story, okay? And that can't be the storyteller.
Let's make this a democracy. Brad, let's talk about Brad. Okay. Bill passed. Brad is president. What do you say to that?
I don't have a story.
Okay. Does anyone else have a story?
Do you have a story?
Tell us a story.
Where you went and what made you feel
better. Tired and weak all the time. And where I went to a lot of them. And something that made me feel better was relaxing and comfort.
And you know, I'm asking you to help with your business.
I went to hospital two times. One time was when I had high fever. It was like more than 40 degrees. And then I was only 3 years old, and my mom and my dad was worried that die somehow, because you know the fever is really high, and I'm only 3 years old, I'm really small. So I had to go to emergency thing. And then I don't know the other thing, but I know that my parents had to ride an ambulance, I think, to take me to the emergency thing, and then we all sorted out. The one time was in elementary school, about 4th grade. I broke my finger at the sports day, so they had to take me to hospital. My dad came from work, and we all sorted out with the doctors. I had, like, what was it?
You remember the parents.
That's, my parents was always here.
That's it makes me hear your story, okay?
When I was born, I was born early because I was physically ill, because I was born in one month.
So you remember your parents? Not the surgery guy.
2 months, and I didn't carry it.
You only remember the surgery.
Maybe it was himself. No, he was six. That was like back in the 70s.
Okay, what about you guys? Do you have any other opinions?
I got my appendix removed, but it was very easy.
Do you remember anything?
Can you just take one of the stories that you spoke about? Tell us a little bit again about what happened, who was there, how they felt, and how it resolved.
So, Varun, when he was 6 years old, he twisted his ankle and he broke it, and this was in France, and he immediately got good health attention. The hospital was less than 15 minutes away, and he got there quickly, and he was with his parents and his brother, which made him feel better, and he and the doctors were able to give him surgery in time, and he seems fine now.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you for sharing your stories. Okay, yeah. Are you going to be our spokesman? Come on. Come up to the front.
Yeah.
How did he turn out? Everything went well? He got some good treatment?
Yeah, everything went well. Jay's still sitting here. Still alive. He's breathing.
And how was he before the tonsillitis? Was he a healthy boy or?
But when the tonsillitis was happening, he said he felt discomfort. Mm-hmm. And had pain in his neck, but I think he was healthy before the pain in his neck.
And everything turned out well, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, all of you, for sharing your stories and coming up to the front. So I'm just going to take a moment here to, if we look at these two lists here, we have, I'm thinking, Varun, you were previously healthy as well, right? So good, healthy kids who got sick within a relatively quick amount of time, had access to hospitals and doctors, had parents or family members who went with them, had good doctors, good treatment, and everything turned out okay. So I'm going to tell you about some of the children I see, and I always think it's very important for us to kind of set the tone of how you felt in these situations, for me to try and, for you to understand how some of the kids I see deal with what's thrown at them. So a lot of the kids who end up at New Delhi Railway Station do come from poor families. As a result, the nutrition, the healthcare they may have had, including vaccinations, haven't been as good and as consistent as all of you. So they do get ill quicker. So they get ill quicker, they pick up the viral flu, any kind of cold or cough, they pick up more easily. And then they're kind of running around in one set of clothes, often barefoot, around the platform, trying to get meals from wherever they can, either begging, either stealing food from the trains. Don't know if you've been on the Indian trains, so there's a whole carriage where all the food is kept. So once the train comes into dock, there's a rush of kids to try and snatch the meals, and it's really a treat to get an omelette or something, because they may only eat one time in the day. And so when these kids would come to my clinic, often they'd have the same things that some of you have had, a tonsillitis, a viral infection, a sprained ankle. A sprained ankle, but they don't come in as healthy as you. So a cough or a cold or tonsillitis doesn't go in 3 or 4 days. It lingers on and on and on. And then they're exposed to various air pollutants and out in the car parks and the train stations. All the pollution from the vehicles that they're exposed to means that their coughs and colds go on for days, 10, 12, 14 days. So it's just not only do they get sicker quicker, but they're also their illnesses last longer. So just think back to when they do get sick and when they do have, the other thing a lot of them do have, street kids have a lot of injuries. So you all live at home, you have doors, you have windows. These kids don't live like that. They sleep on platforms, they sleep on the top of trains. So if they roll off their bed at night, their bed is a carriage, a train carriage. There's no carpet, there's no rug, and there's no one to give them a hug if that happens. They fall onto concrete, maybe down another step. They don't know what's there. There are cuts and bruises with no one to hold them. If they're lucky, they have a friend who brings them. So we run a clinic to see all these people, and it's great. We get funded, and there are so many volunteers and people that work in this clinic. So they are there to give the kindness that sometimes parents can't give. We run big camps for vaccinations, tetanus vaccinations. We run health camps for their communities. So if there are parents or any other, some have parents, some don't, some have families they live with, they can all come and get health care. So very different circumstances to the circumstances your illnesses are in, but at least it's nice to know that there are clinics, there is free health care, so hospitals do that. There are government hospitals. I think Gaia's going to talk about some of the services available. they have their own issues in getting to them. It's not so easy to get to the hospitals, but there are services available. So falling ill for them is a very different experience. Thank you.
Can we all go back to where we were sitting before? There was a few that...
Sure, you can all go back to yours.
And primary trauma care, and we work with the local authorities, police, people who work in a different, like in Fort, in Jodhpur and Jaipur, where you have a lot of accidents. We work with them and we train them how to do the basic first aid when somebody gets injured, which is also very important because lots of deaths in India happens on the road because was not handled properly. And if you ever watch the scenes on the news when the big disaster happens, you will always see people carrying injured and limbs are hanging down, the head is hanging down, the hands are hanging down, and that's what caused further injuries. So public health. What is public health? Do you guys know what is the name public health? Well, it's really, it's a science. It's a way of promoting the health, promoting vaccination, researching disease, providing the healthcare to everybody. And in India, it is pretty good. There is a free healthcare for everyone. Is it accessible? That's a little bit difficult, because especially if you're living outside Delhi, in the small villages, it's very difficult to get. Sometimes people just don't even go to the hospital. They treat themselves on their own. In Delhi, there is a several government hospitals, and they're pretty good, excellent doctors. That's a good side. The bad side is it's very crowded. So if you want to go to a government hospital, it may take you 3 or 4 hours waiting to see a doctor. 3 or 4 hours is a long time for somebody who is sick or injured. There's a private hospital as well, my understanding is that each private hospital in Delhi still must have the sector or a portion of the hospital dedicated for the underprivileged ones, which is a very good thing. And if you ever been to a hospital in Delhi, any of you? So where did you go?
Fortis.
Fortis, was it good? Yeah, it's nice and it's green and you have a good doctors. Have any of you ever been to Safdarjung Hospital or Ames? No. You have to go a queue for about 4 hours to get in and get the treatment. So. But it's there, it's available. There's a lot of little clinics, there's a lot of big hospitals, and it's free. So it's available for everyone. The doctors are great. They have a good, pretty good nursing staff. Not as good as I would wish they had, but it's good. And everybody gets care. So that's the hospitals. They are private and they have a government. And it's great. Most of the places on the West, they don't even have a government hospital anymore. It's only private. You have to pay to go get the treatment. At least here, people get the free care. What else can we talk about public health? Road safety. You know, you see on the road every day, there are accidents. Everybody drives the way they want to. Their cars, their trucks, their animals, their bicycles, their rickshaws, their elephants. On Saturdays, I go with the high school club and we go to the Indian Head Injury Foundation Rehab Center and we work with the people who've been injured and they are very financially in a very bad place, so they need some help. And last week I met a gentleman, he's an artist, and he was walking his dog on the road and he got hit by a buffalo. I mean, it's even unbelievable. You say something like that to the people, when you go back home, they would think, okay, you are totally mad. But that's really what happened. The guy was walking his dog. He got hit by a buffalo, and he hit the head on the road, and he has now neurological damage. So it's very important to talk to educate the people about the safety on the roads, about the handling the injuries on the road, about wearing the seatbelt. You see a lot motorbikes. How often do you see women having a helmet? Very rarely. If you see whole family on the motorbike, there will be three kids, a husband and a wife, and there will be only a husband wearing a helmet. You will very seldom have the whole family wearing a helmet because there's simply no children's size helmets in India. And there is another project going on, helmet for every child, but it's very difficult because there's no helmets. You have to import the helmets from abroad to be able to give it to the children. So there's a lot of ways you can help people, but everything requires really education, even to train them how to do the first aid, basic first aid on the injuries, how to behave on the road, how to drive the car without going on the middle of the yellow lane, how to ride the bicycle and cross the, even the crossing the road. You so often see the people on the middle of the road and they are not even looking left and right. So everything requires education to teach the people how to behave in a certain situation and how to stay healthy. The other big point in the public health is the vaccination. And it's really been lots of NGO work with the Indian government and Indian hospital making sure that everybody gets vaccination. And since 2012, for example, I'm not going to talk about everything, I'll take only 2 points, like polio. India has not single reported polio case, which is amazing. And it was all done by promoting the vaccination and promoting the health and talking about the importance of being vaccinated. The second biggest big problem, I'm not going to talk about TB and all the other cases because I think there's a lot of other project working on that. I'm going to talk about touch base about rabies, how big rabies are in India. Any of you been vaccinated against rabies? Yeah, majority, maybe yes, maybe not. But rabies are big in India. And it's just, people don't pay attention. We have a monkey, we have a dogs, we have a rats, you have a squirrel, they all carry rabies. But we all go by the dog on the street, we all go by the monkey, they come to us and they're friendly and you feed them. But those animals, they carry rabies and vaccinations are very important and it's not promoted over here. And even though there are agencies who work on it, and doctors and the NGOs, it's still something that needs to be addressed seriously. Any? You guys have any question about this? So we can go talk about that later on. And one of the biggest public health project over here is the hygiene. I mean, talk about hygiene. Everything comes really from the hands and from the what you eat. When you ever get sick during the flu season, what they always we put the signs out? Washing your hands. It's so important to wash your hands because many, many disease and illnesses that people get really comes from simple your hands. You touch your computer, you touch your phone being everywhere with you. In the toilet, in the bathroom, in the car, you put it on the road, you put it on the desk. And then you go and you don't think twice, put the phone in a pocket and you go to eat. Very seldom you will go wash your hands. But those little gadgets we have, they also contain lots of germs. Washing hands is very important and promoting health and promoting hygiene is important too. The last couple of years, there's a lot of projects going on in India. And one is providing the toilets for every house. It's a big project to require lots of money and lots of work and lots of discipline, lots of education, but it is in a project and it is in a process and it's absolutely fantastic to be able to provide every person a basic use of a toilet, every house to have a toilet. The second big project that was in India right now is also keeping the street vendors food, the street vendors hygiene, teaching them how to maintain a healthy hygiene while you are serving the food. And that's the project that started on this December. And I think it's really amazing to have an organization who is going to go and train the street vendors how to keep the healthy food and how to serve the clean food so you don't get sick, so you can go out and eat the kebabs and not worry that the lettuce is going to be safe to wrap the kebab in, and we all like that. We all like to go out and eat street food, but it's always risk that you might get some stomach problem. So there is actually an organization who is going to work and make sure that the street vendors are trained properly, and how it's called actually Clean Street Food Project. And if you look a little bit on the website, you will see lots of people involved working in this. I can go on forever about talking about public health and the things that one can do to promote health. But we're going to just stop at this, and we were going to give you some time to ask the question, and we can discuss anything that we talked about. I'm sure you have lots of on your mind. How about that?
To healthcare, and one of the main problems that is pretty apparent in terms of rural healthcare and in the more urban cities is that even though most of India's population is in rural India, there isn't enough equipment and infrastructure available there compared to, say, 30% of the population in urban areas. Is that a major problem as well?
I think it is, and I learned that the good person I spoke about this thing is Dr. Yadav, who works with the Reach Out. He's been coming here for the last 30 years every Thursday. What he sees, for example, the people, when you live in a small village, they try to treat themselves first, and they will only come to see a doctor when you are almost in a very bad state, because there's a lot of village doctors, they call them village doctors, they like to treat, and they're not really doctors, they're just trained to do some herbal medicine or different treatments, but they are not trained doctors. So what they do is they try to do that themselves, and then they will come to see a doctor in the village or in a big town once you come to the point that there is a little or no help left. So I think a lack of enough of the, there's not enough medical facilities, I think, and also lack of education, information to the people that you should go. If you get bitten by a dog or you fall down and you have a swollen ankle, you should really go to a hospital and have it checked instead of trying to treat locally in the village. And then once you can't walk anymore or you are really ill because the dog had a rabies and you come then to the hospital, it's too late. So I think that there is a lot of, there is a shortage of the facilities outside, even in Delhi. I mean, when Max Hospital opened in 2005 or 6, I'm not sure when, it was, you will go in there and it's not crowded. And now when you go in Max Hospital, in emergency room, it's always flooded with people. Apollo Hospital, Fortis, anywhere you go, there's always lots of people. There's just, I think there's not enough facilities to accommodate the population.
The other thing, Bharat, I don't know if you've come across, so there are three types of care: primary care, secondary care, tertiary care. So primary care is a GP who will see you for your first point of contact. And then if you need a little bit of specialist care, you go to a secondary care. And then typically urban centers have the tertiary care hospital. But there are so many factors that govern how these families get to health care. So like Gaia said, if you were just to come to the doctor with a simple issue, a medical doctor, not like make a paste of some flour and something and wrap it around, turmeric and wrap it around, that there are basic facilities which are very accessible to a lot of people. But for example, if a mother gets ill, she's the last person to see a doctor. She has to run her house and look after the kids and cook food, and it's only till she can't perform those activities that the family will bring her to see the doctor. Whereas if the earning breadwinner gets sick, the man, very quickly is he seen. So it's very complicated.
So what might have taken 5 days would then take two weeks or longer to resolve. And so ultimately the issue complicates itself because they didn't get the right care in time.
And also, I just had a question. Is primary care, it's usually more cheap, right?
Yes, absolutely. It's much cheaper because it's a first point of call. So if you think, for example, primary care is when you have a headache. You go to see someone, you take a Procine, or maybe you just need to drink more fluids, or maybe you need your eyes checked. You have a headache, it's fairly simple. And then, if you think, okay, now those treatments, let's maybe see a neurologist. So that's secondary care. So the neurologist says, oh, we might need to do this and that, we might need to do a CT scan. So already you're at more cost. And then if they say, okay, now in the CT scan, this mass that you have is in a position that's very difficult for us to access, only the tertiary care specialist, neurosurgeon, one is who sits in Delhi can see it, then you're into lakhs of money for that operation.
Any other questions?
I have a question about AIDS and HIV. How do the hospitals tell people to prevent it or talk about it in the first place?
AIDS and HIV.
So, as yeah, I mean, unfortunately, like, sex education is not really a concept that's done in the public school system. Like the classes that you guys have had, your health classes. NGOs come in and host sessions for the schools, but as a government, it's not something that's discussed freely and openly, sadly,
yeah.
Although the need is so great.
And also I think the families don't talk about it. There's lots of myths about it. You know, people have lots of stigma. If somebody is a sick child, they really don't like to talk about it. I'm not talking about Delhi. If you're talking when you leave the Delhi, go to the villages. And even in Delhi, some families, they will not talk about it. The family member is ill, especially not if they have AIDS. I know that Apollo Hospital has an AIDS center, and if the people who are HIV positive have AIDS, they have a free treatment there. It's available. Is it accessible to everybody? That's the problem, because if people, when you are in Delhi, you are kind of having a top of the line medical services available in India, but when you live in the small areas, outside Delhi or outside big towns, big cities, it's very difficult to get even the primary care, let alone if you're like, and to get even tested, I think people, but by the time they go to get tested, it will be probably in the last, later stage of the disease. So that's really, it's all about sex education, mm-hmm. and in general about just the education about the health and staying healthy and going to the doctors when you need to.
Have you heard of universal precautions in your research? So universal precautions means for any healthcare worker looking after any patient, you take certain precautions to protect yourself. So whether you glove up. So those are known as for anybody, because if there's a person in a car who's had a car accident or someone comes into the emergency room, your first team that touches you, contacts you, you have no idea. You haven't had a chance to take a history. Are you a hemophiliac? Do you have HIV? Do you have hepatitis B? So all first response teams take universal precautions, which is you're gloved up, you're masked up, you may have a gown on if it's particularly messy. So actually HIV should be, you are actually protected from HIV with universal precautions. So whether you know that the patient has it, any blood-to-blood contact, any bodily fluid, vaginal fluid, semen fluid, saliva, as long as you're protected, you shouldn't come into contact with the HIV virus. Now what happens in India is there just aren't enough gloves to go around, there aren't enough aprons to go around. So often your blood, for example, if you just have a blood test, the phlebotomist will do it without gloves. Now that's not universal precautions, and that shouldn't be done. And I made the transition during my training to learning with bare hands, and then when universal precautions came in, we had to take blood with gloves, and you're a bit more fumbly because it's not so easy to palpate the vein and take blood, but it just becomes part of what you do. So the thing is then, you can educate your teams, your doctors and nurses about these precautions, but then the hospital has to be able to support that. For example, there's a hospital that I used to work at in Ukla, and what they do with the gloves, so latex disposable gloves are meant to be one-time use. And what they do is they fill them up with water to make sure there was no leaking water and say, okay, these are okay for reuse. So they're trying to save themselves because they don't have resources. But really it becomes a much bigger government issue of providing the resources in order for healthcare workers to maintain these universal protections.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm researching about tuberculosis, and I'm
yet, and I'm just wondering how education affects TB, like how, you know, like some kids are, they are not educated about TB, and they are not aware of like how people get TB, and then how it can spread to them, and how they can treat it out. I'm just wondering how it affects in that way.
I'm sure that you guys know that how much I chase you to get your TB test done every 2 years. The reason is that because TB is quite big in India, and lately there is a big drug resistant tuberculosis. How is promoted locally? I think it is. You can see even the ads on the streets. You know, when you cough, when you breathe, you cover your mouth. You know, the same with the flu, the same with the TB. But you really don't know when somebody has a tuberculosis. So when you spend an excessive amount of time with somebody, I'm not going to get it. If you have it and you talk to me, I'm not going to get it. You need to spend a little room at night together with a person in the room who has a tuberculosis for another person together. If you go in the metro every day and the same people in the metro, your driver, people who work in the house, if you're in a class with a person who has a tuberculosis and you don't know, that's how you get it. You do not get it, but simply it's, we've done lots of research on tuberculosis because of having a huge population, making sure that everyone stays healthy while at school. And also, I think every school in Delhi does that. They have a huge project to talk about tuberculosis. It's not, and it's pretty much under control, but there are still plenty of cases, and it's, I think that public, that lots of hospitals are very well equipped and trained for the tuberculosis, and the treatment is very good. It's available for everybody. Again, the question is, does the person comes to the doctor and seek the treatment, and also the treatment for tuberculosis in 9 months, and you start feeling better after a month and a half, and lots of people stop taking medication, and that's the biggest problem, and that's how you end up with a drug-resistant tuberculosis. So, whenever a doctor says you need a 5 days of antibiotics, there's a reason for that. You have to finish the course, and the TB treatment is 9 months, and it's a long treatment, and lots of people give up after 3 months, because they're already better, and they don't know that by not doing the treatment for 9 months, you're not fully recovered, still carrying it, and also you are kind of helping building this drug resistant disease.
Yeah, ultimately education is at the base of all of these issues, and so without an education, even the signs that you go to the hospital, those won't make sense to you. So I think when you are trying to teach in, you know, somewhat of an electric community, the adults, at least the children, are starting to get more educated. Radio and TV are better forms of imparting the education. Because they're listening, they're not having to read themselves. So a lot of that stuff has to be factored in, is that who is the most vulnerable community, and are they able to take, you know, of course there's so many languages in India, of course, so you have to then impart that education in ways that everybody can digest it.
So I think that's very true. The mismatch between often what the government throws out there as education and the populations that receive it are huge. So the government may think that they've got billboards and leaflets and pamphlets and hospital boards, but the people who need to be able to read it can't read it. So you then have to be very creative in your education, and you have to do focus groups, you have to concentrate on women in communities. So I'll tell you about a project we did. We took these women and we put their hands in chili powder. And we said, okay, now rub your eyes. And they're like, oh no, we wouldn't do that. And we said, okay, you can see the chili powder, but you can't see the germs. If you put your hands on the floor of the toilet, you just can't see the germs. That doesn't mean they're not there. So in terms of these very small focus groups and creative methods, you can actually be really effective without written billboards to teach these communities about microorganisms and then the ill effects of them.
You were mentioning that how treatment gets more expensive from primary to secondary to tertiary care, and that kind of one of my causes for my problem was that the mass majority of the Indian population doesn't have insurance for healthcare. So are there any organizations that are trying to expand the amount of people given insurance, because that really puts people into poverty when they have to sell, say, a plot of land or take take someone out of education. So is there any?
I don't know, but this was a statistic from a while ago, which is 17 million people are thrown below the poverty line every year from healthcare expenses, which is huge. I mean, people give up their lives, their homes, their land, their jewelry to cover medical expenses, partly because they come into it so late and the costs are so high. I can try and find the source of that statistic for you because I heard that lecture a few years ago. But I don't know. I mean, insurance schemes, I think, are trying to be more creative. You do have employers who will now, like a lot of the big companies, when they hire someone, they'll say, as kind of an enticement thing, we'll cover your insurance and your immediate family. So I think, again, in a population that's so big and so varied, those creative solutions are going to help the most. But I don't know any companies that are...
I heard of one, you know, they have through the LR program, there's sort of subsets where you can be eligible for certain insurance packages. It's the same thing. I'll give you an example of the person who cleans the outside of my house. Now, she's a single mother, has three kids, takes care of her parents. Her husband is a drunkard. And she's extremely, extremely poor and completely uneducated. And so a lot of the things that are available that the Indian government has made available to her, she has no access to. So we can be like, oh, but you go sign up for this program. You're eligible for this because you're below the poverty line. There's three of these. She's like, where will I ever hear of this? And then who will fill out the paperwork for her? So ultimately, the things that the Indian government is doing is not making, is not getting, it's almost not, it, they're too far below to even get to that point. Where how do they, A, hear about it and feel empowered to go ask about it? See, ultimately, I think what we all have to remember is that education empowers people so much. So people who... Like, the person who works in my house, I asked her to open her bank account. She's like, I can't operate it. I don't know how to read in Hindi or in English. So even operating an ATM is incredibly intimidating to them. So filling out paperwork, even if it's a free form, to ask any question, to go submit it, it's like they have to take their children's help for everything. And so the education becomes sort of the stumbling block for a lot of these issues.
I want to bring something up. So even sometimes you do have access. I had a parent who came to me a couple of months ago, and he said that he noted there was a family with a child who needs a kidney transplant. And he was willing to pay the family. His family said, we want to pay for the transplant. How do we start that? So I helped them out. We went to the center in Apollo Hospital. They say, okay, let's start. So we start the process. The mother is a perfect match. We've done all the blood tests and everything needed. So mother is going to be, it will be like transplant, so mother is going to donate one kidney to the child, and she was 16 years old, yeah? So we've done absolutely everything. The money was there, the doctors were there doing it, the doctor, they would just do the whatever is necessary, they're not going to charge for the doctor's fees, just whatever is needed to cover the surgery. And the day has come, they said we're not going to do it. So we sat down with the translator, the person who could speak fluent English, and asked the father of the family, why you would not want to save your 16-year-old daughter? Because like this, she's on the dialysis, she's not going to make it, you know, maybe a couple more years. So he said two reasons. One is, I look very bad in my community that I have somebody pay for my daughter's kidney. Second, if my wife gives the kidney, now I have two sick people. And she cannot work and she cannot do anything. So he decided not to do it. And we can't force somebody to have a surgery. So even though it was really heartbreaking to see the 16-year-old who was hoping that she'll be off the machines and she will be, you know, up and about and going to school again, she was not able to get that kidney because of the stigma of, you know, I'm gonna have now two sick women in the family and I don't want my community to think that somebody else paid for it, I should be a man of the family, I should provide and I should have the money to pay for it. It's a lot of different issue we have here, not only having a doctor to provide the care, it's a whole thing together.
Any other questions?
Is there anything education and stuff connected to like water pollution?
To what?
Water pollution.
Clean water?
Yeah.
it's a big, the water is really the source of lots of disease in India, and we all know that, why we drink in the bottled water, because there's a, the water in there is bad. There is a, I think there's a little dam to clean the dairy water, because it's a huge project. It's something, it's not only you put the tap on, the problem with the dairy water that is the sewage system. So you have to change the infrastructure of the city to be able to get the clean water, unless you have a proper filtration, like how, you know, in school we have a filtration so you can drink from every tap. But that's something that probably eventually it will come, but I'm not aware of it now. Or maybe it is there, but I will have to research on that. Because it's one of the biggest problem and biggest project that they need to do in Delhi, to have a clean water.
In the school that we work with, the kids drink from the tap. I don't know whether it's filtered or not, but and a lot of them live in Vivekananda camp and Sanjay camp, which is next to the Real Museum. And I had spoken to them about water, they all drink from straight from the tap. There isn't drinking water and normal water, it's they drink the water that runs from the tap, which, you know, at homes we don't end up doing. We end up having a filtration system or drinking the normal water. So I think oftentimes what we think is clean water for us, for them, they think that's perfectly fine. I mean, yeah, they're not going to drink from the Yamuna, but they think that the tap water that's coming out is perfectly fine to drink.
Well, sometimes they don't have a choice.
Yeah, they have no choice. But
that a corporation water is what they have to drink, because that's the only thing they have access to.
But a lot of places, they do have an RO system. And I worked in one school, it's a government school, and we worked with the Rotary Club of India. And the project that we done was putting the filtration in the school, so the kids would have actually drinking water. And it wasn't lots of money. It was a very, very small project. But we installed the whatever they are called, the RO systems. And it gives the drinking water for the whole school. So, but, you know, it's one school. And lots of private schools, they have it, or public schools, but the government school, they don't. And that's where the majority of the kids go to the government schools, because they are free.
Your project sounds so good. Any other questions?
What other project do we have here? So TV, water.
Do we want to go quickly around and you just
give us a little one sentence
about your project? Go ahead, you can start.
I'm doing infant mortality.
Sanitation.
Sanitation.
I'm doing HIV and AIDS.
Okay.
It should be the same.
Malaria.
Sorry?
Malaria.
Malaria. Oh, okay.
Water pollution in the Yamuna.
Okay.
Dengue.
Dengue.
And initially.
Ooh, we didn't talk about dengue.
Yeah. Sorry, what was it? TB?
Access to healthcare in India. No, malaria virus.
TV.
Mosquito disease.
Agricultural
child labor.
Oh, we've got some budding public health.
I know. So any question on malaria and mosquito-borne dengue, chikungunya, any of that stuff? Well, you guys are pretty well informed. There's a lot out there.
So I saw an article that shows the dengue virus vaccines. And it's discovered by the scientists before, but is there any like vaccine for the malaria virus? And if there is a vaccine, then is it used for the people who got infected with malaria?
To my knowledge, there's still no vaccine for malaria. They're working on it forever, but no. I don't know how you're talking only about India about malaria. You're gonna talk in general malaria. You're talking about malaria.
Oh,
in India.
Just based on India.
In India. Okay, so yeah, so. And you've done your research, there is very little malaria in Delhi, but it's mainly in the rural areas. There is no vaccine that I'm aware of, and I know they work on it, but there is still no vaccine. And to my knowledge, the latest one is that there is also drug resistant for malaria, not in India yet, but there is coming from Africa and other parts of the world.
The one thing with malaria really is prevention, is the biggest focus. So even the WHO focus is on prevention. For example, when you know, the huts in rural villages are made of cow dung patties, so all those crevices are where the mosquitoes hide. So nets, I think, have been proven to be the most effective, lowest cost preventative measure. And then it goes back to really reducing the kind of structure of the hut, so where the mosquitoes hide, draining stagnant water. So a lot of the WHO efforts have to be on prevention until a viable vaccine is formed.